Dual Class Arena has been out for a week, and we hope you guys have had fun so far. Our arena expert Tachii got multiple 12 wins already, and we'd like to share one today. We'll go through the draft and have some highlights of the run at the end. Quick disclaimer, the card quality is really strong in this arena deck, but there are still several drafting and gameplay decisions that can turn the tide. Let's get right into it. Now, if all you want to do is pick the best class, here's what we did in our selection. We went with Shaman for two reasons. First, Paladin has a weak pool of cards right now due to recent changes to the appearance rate of its more powerful cards. Second, as we discussed in one of our previous class spotlights, Rogue has a really good hero power that we want to take as a second hero. We were thankfully rewarded as we got Rogue right after. As Shaman Rogue, you're basically playing a tempo class. This means trying to curve out from turn 3 to turn 5, having a couple of large removal options and some finishers. In the first few picks, we were simply picking the best cards. If you have any questions, comment below. Let's go through it. This third pick presented us some options for the draft. All three cards are pickable, but what do you value the most? Remember, we want to occupy the board early and use tempo to our advantage. Zap is one of the best disruptors of tempo, and we'd love to have one in the deck. We don't have any removal at this point, so it's a great card to pick up. The next pick is also interesting. It's easy to look at Toxicologist being a good card when you can dagger up. However, it provides subpar stats for 2 mana, and you can't play it on turn 2. On turn 4, let's be honest, you'd rather play a 4-4 instead of a 2-2. Thus, we went with a Coppertail. Here we went with a cheap shot over Assassinate because of its flexibility. It can remove a large threat in the late game, or it can remove some small minions in the mid game. It's not a tempo card, but it gave our draft flexibility, which made our arena deck even stronger. In these next choices, we simply pick the next cards. Wargear was picked here since we got Coppertail Imposter already, and Wargear curves really well into it. The Ziliax right after was picked for the same reason. These next few picks, we were just picking the best cards. Here's another top bucket pick. All three cards are draftable, however, since we don't have the Shaman hero power, Flame Tongue is a bit worse and we currently don't have enough taunts to support it. Bone Mare is an easy tempo finisher to take here, and that's what we went with. We didn't really consider the Earth Elemental because you're effectively paying 8 mana for a 7-8 taunt. There are better finishers out there. This is another interesting pick. Again, all three cards are draftable. Stormwind Champion is a great card right now, given how there's not much removal at the moment. Walnut Sprite can be useful for your turn 3 and turn 6. At pick 17, we can still use more 3 drops since we only have 2 thugs right now. Ultimately, we picked the Gastropod because you can also play it on turn 3 and have a significant impact later on. Okay, here, Furious Etten is a great taunt for a class that'll need taunts to survive. However, we also want premium 1 drops. Firefly is basically the best 1-drop, and its ability to combo with Vilespine makes the card extremely strong in this deck. Remember, with Rogue's hero power, you want strong 1-drops. At this point, we can consider the Argent Commander, but Sea Giant is just the best tempo big minion you can ask for. Keep watching, because in the highlights to come, we'll show you just how strong Sea Giant really is. We were very excited to see a legendary here, but none of them are that good. We took the Hemet here because it at least gives you competitive stats for its mana cost. In the highlights to come, Hemet acted as a means of guaranteeing strong late game draws when needing to finish a game. Keep in mind, now that we're past pick 20, we want to think about the curve a bit more. This deck can use 3 more 3s and 2 more 4s. We want to fill that up as best as we can. Now, although Spring Rocket is a 3-drop, it's a conditional one. Volcanosaur, on the other hand, is a great finisher. We can use that one more big minion, so we went with a big boy. Pick 25 was a difficult choice. As we look at the deck already, we have Cheap Shot, Sap, and Vilespine already. However, our early game is still a bit shaky. Plated Beetle is a great 2-drop for Rogue due to the heal, so we went with that. The next 2-drops are fairly obvious for being decent 4-drops. We're not happy to skip out on Bloodlust, but we don't really have a deck for it. Swamp Leech is a great pickup here to shore up our early game. It's just a lot better than Cheat Death, which is a lot slower. For the last pick, we had to consider the curve. Charge Devilsar is a great card, but we already have 5 6-plus mana cards. At the same time, we like to have at least 6 3-drops as a rogue, so we went with the weapon to make sure our early game is solid. Now, let's look at the deck's win condition. It wants to curve out with a dagger on turn 2, followed by strong 3s, 4s, and 5s. With Fungalmancer, double Sea Giant, and some mech synergy, we can try and finish games past turn 6. We have the removal to get through taunts, and we have enough taunts and heal of our own to ward off early aggression. With all of this in mind, let's take a look at how this deck did against similarly strong decks toward the end of this run. Here at 10 wins, we're facing against an extremely aggressive deck. However, we were able to play a Sea Giant at a discount. This perfectly shows the meta state right now. the opponent is playing strong on-curve minions from the start, which can just flat out win the game. At the same time, minions like Sea Giant that you can play very cheaply are also incredibly strong, because there's a lack of hard removal. In this game, we made a risk assessment and went face with the Sea Giant to set up lethal next turn, despite being behind on board the entire game. This decision was based on his limited hand size and the inability for him to deal with the Sea Giant currently on his board. The Warlock has to top deck a removal, because he couldn't remove the Sea Giant last turn. We made the decision and were rewarded with a win! Now let's look at the final boss. In Constructed, Hench Clan Thug and Odd Rogue is extremely strong. The same applies here. In this final boss matchup, we see that the Thug was removed the turn after, but the opponent had to spend a coin and a premium removal on a 3-drop. Later, we see the Sea Giant coming out on turn 5, which is insanely strong. The opponent is forced to have another answer, but fortunately for us, he didn't. At the same time, we were able to tempo with Sap and remove his 5-drop minion. He could play it again, but risks dying to the snail. We also chose to only play the snail to avoid dying from Defile. The only really punishing play here is Super Collider. There's obviously a high chance he might have it, but there's a higher chance he'll have Defile. Once again, we made a risk assessment that allowed us to find the best lines. As the game progressed, you see the Sea Giant hitting face after turn 5 several times and eventually killing the opponent. And there you have it, our 12-win Shaman Rogue. Our deck was incredibly strong, but our draft decisions and gameplay decisions also made a difference. Cards that cheat tempo such as Sea Giant and Sap were great for the deck. If we didn't set up lethal, we might lose by giving the opponent more turns to find an answer. In summary, we strongly recommend taking Rogue as the hero power. It's important to keep in mind to draft your deck based on the hero power you have, not the first class that was offered. In our previous video, we suggested Warrior Rogue might be bad due to redundancy in weapons. However, unlike the last dual class arena, there are barely any class cards. Thus, you can avoid Warrior weapons and only pick weapons such as Super Collider to strengthen the deck. With a more aggressive hero power, you can draft a strong curve with high quality cards to beat the opponent. And that's it! An example of a 12-win deck in dual class! If you have crazy games and decks you experienced, comment below! And as always, like and subscribe if you enjoyed the video for more quality Hearthstone content. Thanks for watching!